redemption for Denny Morrison, Lucas Makowski, and Matthew Giroux.
They have no individual medals, and they want a gold here against the American men.
It was their fast skates and an innovative technique that gave them the winning edge.
So close! Canada! Gold medal!
Days earlier, it was Christina Grove's turn to shine.
Can she hang on?
Gliding across the ice to capture a medal in the 1500 meters, adding to her bronze in the 3000. But it was London, Ontario's Christine Nesbitt who captured the golden title at the Oval, winning the 1000 meters.
Charging to the finish in the race of her life. Will it be good enough? Yes, it is!
Parents and coach looking on with pride. This season, Christine has been virtually unbeatable.
I've surprised myself in a lot of ways. Like, to be world sprint champion is not something that I necessarily thought I could win, particularly this season. I'm a perfectionist, so it's nice to be so far perfect in the season in my specialty distances. But there's always work to be done, and I can never get lazy or take anything for granted because those girls don't want me to win. They want to win just as badly as I do. Right now, everything's working really well for me, and I hope that I can continue that for the next three seasons.
The Richmond Olympic Oval produced a great success story for Canada during the Games, and it's now a great post-Olympic success story. The Oval is a good example of the legacy of Vancouver 2010. When the Games ended, the track was taken out and the building transformed into a multi-purpose recreation center. The center's various facilities are open to the public. One of Canada's long track medalists in 2010 we haven't mentioned yet is Clara Hughes. Clara retired after winning bronze in Vancouver, ending a brilliant skating career with international acclaim and an Order of Canada. But hang on, Clara isn't done with the Olympics yet. She hopes to compete in the 2012 Summer Games in London, but on a very different track than the one she raced on in Vancouver.
What does Clara Hughes have in store in her final Olympic race?
Clara Hughes could not have asked for a better ending to her speed skating career.
Here she comes, remarkable, incomparable.
Having the race of her life at home with an entire nation watching.
Canadian Olympic legend, the race may be done, the story may not be done at all.
The six-time Olympic medalist has had more than her share of great memories. But for her, Vancouver was it.
Oval record!
I had this moment of awe, this moment of, I finally did it. I finally allowed the best race, the most perfect, beautiful skating technique that I dreamed of executing. I finally let it live its life. It's done. I'm finished. That's the last time I'll skate.
Hughes is the only athlete in history to win multiple medals in both the Winter and Summer Olympics. As a cyclist, she established herself as one of the world's best, winning two bronze medals at the 96 Games in Atlanta. But Clara Hughes has always been someone who pushed herself. And in 2001, she took up speed skating. 1 year later, she won bronze in Salt Lake, followed by gold in Turin. Her Vancouver bronze was her fourth and final skating medal.
A remarkable way for a remarkable athlete to end an Olympic career.
But after the high of Vancouver, Hughes became restless. And cycling re-entered the picture.
I feel like I finally know how to go about sport in the right way, and I want to apply this to cycling and to see what I can do. And then hopefully finish with that same feeling of that was the best I had inside of me and it lived its life. And I want that to happen in London.
Three, two, one.
Whether she makes the London team or not, Clara Hughes hopes Canada's 2012 Olympians will experience the magic she felt in Vancouver.
I'll never ever forget the energy of the crowd, and I felt like my heart was open, my mind was open, and all of that energy was just channeling inside of me. And when I was skating, it was feeding me, and it gave me wings. I think that Canadians of all walks of life, of all ages, connected to something special. And that connection that was made is something that's not forgotten. And I think we're going to see a very different kind of enthusiasm as the Summer Olympics roll near and as London draws closer. We're going to see something in Canadians that the Summer Olympics have never seen in this country since Montreal.
If she makes the team, and anyone who knows Clara is confident she will, Clara Hughes will be one of the many Canadian athletes to watch in London.
And joining me now, as he did 1 year ago, is CTV chief news anchor Lloyd Robertson. I'm not sure what memories lie in store for us in London. We'll both be there, but I tell you, this city and Whistler, they provided enough memories to go to London and well beyond.
Oh, did they ever, Brian. And it's hard to believe that 1 year has expired already.
Yeah, it really is. And speaking of 1 year, it was 1 year ago we sat in the studio about 100 meters from here. You did an essay and you talked about a profound change taking place in this country.
It was absolutely a transforming moment for Canada. And we also wondered whether we could make it last. And I know that people have been saying the same things to you over the last year as they've been saying to me. And that is, we couldn't leave our television sets during those weeks in February. So we imagined this long string of glittering lights from coast to coast to coast as Canadians reveled in this shared national experience. And that's the kind of thing we want to hang on to. So in addressing Clara Hughes' point about are Canadians ready to support summer athletes the way they supported winter athletes, I would say they are more than ready to do that. And you know, I've been covering major national events in this country, Brian, for 50 years more. And I was trying to find a thread to explain what happened here in Vancouver, this cresting of togetherness. And one familiar symbol kept coming to mind. We weren't always big on flag waving in this country. I guess we didn't think of it as being, well, Canadian. But the red and white has become such a part of who we are. It's hard to think of a time when it wasn't around. Well, there was. 1964, Tokyo. The first Olympics I covered. Canada marched in behind the red ensign. Part British, part Canadian, a hybrid of a flag. Hardly a symbol, many believed, for a coming-of-age country. There was a plan for a new Canadian flag, but the idea divided us. There were bitter accusations it was a betrayal of our British heritage.
You can sense it here this morning in this biting winter air. Slowly and majestically, a page is turning.
Yet, on February 15th, 1965, I was there when the red maple leaf was raised for the first time as Canada's flag. Its birth had been difficult, but it immediately attracted the youthful spirit of the country.
I like the new flag because it's the first flag Canada's had, and it's the official one.
Slowly, thread by thread, it grew on us as we ourselves grew.
I'm Lloyd Robertson, and we are at Expo 67.
In Canada's centennial year, at the World's Fair in Montreal, people from all over the globe told me the same thing. You have a great country here. More and more of us began to believe it too. September 1972, Canada versus the Soviet Union, in the depth of the Cold War. Eight wonderful, excruciating games. And finally,
get another shot right by the door! And they're done! And scores for Canada!
Now that was nation building. Our pride continued to grow through the unifying power of sport and with the maple leaf out front.
And the competitions begin officially at 8:30 tomorrow morning.
Hosting the world at the 1976 Olympic Games in Montreal. Then again in 1988, Calgary. But only a handful of medals for Canada. Not one gold. So we asked ourselves, if we can stage the Olympics as well as anyone, what would it mean to us if we won them? British Columbia would answer that forever. 14 gold medals, more than any other country at one Winter Games. Canadians united in a grand crescendo of national togetherness. A contagious sense of pride and passion I had never witnessed before. And always there was the flag, now part of our everyday lives. Tangible proof that at last we share a proud confidence in who we are. And we like it.
Canada has been called a country with no identity. We don't have a rallying point. We're not flag wavers. In this moment, in Vancouver, we became a nation of flag wavers. I saved for 7 years for the Vancouver Olympics, and it was worth every penny.
Coming up, the votes are in. Canadians choose their favorite moment of Vancouver 2010. The Vancouver 2010.